Lots and lots of fans here at the Coliseum for the long-awaited home opener here. The Islanders and the Hurricanes will take center stage. Closed captioning is brought to you by the New York Lottery. Hey, you never know. One thing the Islanders do know is they're coming in confident tonight, having beat the Carolina Hurricanes last night with a final score of 5-3. It was a successful game, especially on the power play. Lots of chemistry there, especially with the new guy on there with Johnny Boychuk. They got contributions from four different players when it comes to goals, and they're hoping to have similar offensive success tonight. We're going to go up to the guys right now. Puck drop is just moments away. Butch and Howie, take it away.
All right, Shannon, thanks very much. You know, there were about 10,000 people in their seats, really not in their seats, standing, yelling and screaming, even before the Islanders hit the ice. Over on the Islander bench, equipment people Charlie Ness and Shaky Krause got huge cheers when they came down the runway. That's how enthusiastic this crowd is tonight. And this Islander group, of course, are going to try to feed off of that. But there could be a little danger early on. Can't they, Butch, in having too much adrenaline?
Well, they want to perform and they want to do well. And they recognize the passion of the fans. I've heard John Tavares mention it several times. And this is a very passionate group. They remember the playoff series, Howie. So, yeah, they've got to take that emotion and push it in the right direction, not let it get the best of them. Well, that man there leading the way, John Tavares, he knows how to do that. He'll lead his team.
Now, Franz Nielsen's line starts out. That's with Bailey on the left and Kuhlman on the right. Hickey and Hamonic are the defense, and it's the Eric Staal line for the Hurricanes. Staal is number 12 with Alexander Semin, number 28, Yuri Telushny, number 19, and on defense, Justin Falk, number 27, Andre Sekera, number 4 for the Hurricanes. And this is Sekera being chased by Kuhlman, who finishes his check. Looked around the boards by Falk. Hickey jumps in. So immediately an Islander defenseman activates and then fires one towards the net that's swept away by Falk.
Now you're going to see a lot of the pinching defensemen from the New York Islanders this season. Jack Capuano wants to spend a lot more time in the offensive zone, and that's one way to do it.
Chad Johnson in his Islander debut handling the puck in that somewhat widened trapezoid. It's worked around the center as Patrick Dwyer, number 39, was tangled up with Tavares. The puck back in the Hurricane zone. A minute into the opening period, and an icing possible here. And they do call the icing. They'll bring the faceoff into the Hurricane zone. Run to the other side, get acquainted with this fellow from Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, out of the University of Alaska Fairbanks, who had quite a season last year.
Yeah, he brings some real strong credentials with him from Boston, the 17 wins. And he's going to play an important role with the Islanders this year. He's got to have some big games. He's got to win some games, not only at home, but on the road. So Jack Capuano hands it off to him early and says, hey, kid. Well, he's not really a kid. Let's see what you can do.
Now Johnson handles the puck, gives it away. Dwyer centers. Johnson got back to make the stop on McClement. And there's no further play.
Well, that might be a sign of things to come, a good sign. Yes, he did give the puck away, but he got himself back into position. And that could have just as easily have gone in, Howie. It was a good shot by Dwyer. Watch Johnson as he doesn't get a good pass away. And there's the quick release. There's the shot there. Beautiful save on McClement by Johnson. So that's a good omen for me.
All right, so you forget the giveaway and you take the save.
That's right.
It's better than 50-50.
That's all that matters is make the save. If you make a mistake, you got to make the save.
Got to love it. Butchie's glass is three quarters full.
But he was really excited to come here, Howie. You know, it's an opportunity. He felt he was going to get an opportunity to play. And he says the Islanders are an up-and-coming team. He really believes these guys are ready to make a move, and he wants to be a part of it.
Well, now Brian Strait paired with Griffin Reinhart on defense. His parents in the building once again, including former National Hockey Leaguer Paul Reinhart. It's Griffin's mom, as far as dad, his mom, Teresa, is here again. And this is Reinhart playing it across to Ryan Strome. Strome, number 18, somewhat quietly, had a couple of assists last night.
I thought he had a very strong game, Howie. He kept it very simple, was aggressive on the forecheck, made a couple of real heady plays. Good start for him.
Grabowski to Hamonic. That drive tipped loose. Ends up in the corner. Strome's got it. Grabowski gave it up to Rask. And the puck wheeled to the blue line and out. Now Hamonic chasing back. And icing call.
Had an opportunity to talk to Bill Peterson about his team's performance last night. He said the one thing that he didn't like was his play along the boards. He thought his wingers needed to be much stronger and play a lot better in their own zone. Again, this is a good forecheck by the Islanders. Good support by one another. Ryan Strom gets to the front of the net looking for that screen shot, but that's what you want on a good forecheck is good support.
Cizik has put it off the goaltender Hudobin with Clutterbuck there. Now it's Cizikas getting it loose. Martin, deep angle. Penalty coming up to the Hurricanes. Johnson racing to the bench. Hamonic a shot. Fluttered away. Martin took a little tug in pursuit of that puck. Crowd wants two penalties here. Clutterbuck tees it up, shoots, and a save by Hudobin. And let's see if we're getting one or two penalties. We know there's a slash. Will there be a hook as well? Because Martin was slowed down.
Carolina 14, 2 minute minor slash.
Just the slash, that's it.
Yeah, slash to Gerby. But talk about a big shift for your fourth line, if you want to call him that. With Cizikas, Martin, and Clutterbuck going to work down low, owning the boards, owning the puck retrieval, making good plays, making life tough for the Hurricanes, and gives the Islanders a good power play opportunity, and they were good last night.
Two out of three on the power play in Raleigh. This Islanders power play is brought to you by New York Lottery. Hey, you never know. 2:44, the time of the Gerby slashing penalty. So for the Islanders, this is Boychuk. Presumably with enough sleep after the tailgaters got him up early. Nielsen brings it in. Down the board. Shoots one looking short side. Hudobin said no. Nelson for Nielsen. Tavares in front of Oposo. Save made. What a setup from Tavares to Oposo. And the Hurricanes clear. Well, we got used to that for a good chunk of last year.
Big save by Hudobin, really, on Kyle Oposo, but you're right, terrific setup. All set up by the breakout for the New York Islanders. Again, we talked about them the other day, or last night, Howie, about how many breakouts they have with the dead weight pages of breakouts and plays.
Boychuk, and now Tavares drives one, he scores!
You need to get off on the right foot. The power play is one way to do it. And again, the Islanders, with the quick puck movement, first they're able to establish possession, control in the offensive zone, and then they go to work with the quick passes on the stick. Again, there's the pass all the way back up to the top. Right away, Boychuk all the way back to Tavares, and he just rifles it. So a lot of movement for the goaltender to have to deal with. Partially screened, I believe, right over the right shoulder. Tremendous shot by John Tavares.
And that's something that John spent more time working on this summer. He'd worked last summer on one-timers, but here he was talking yesterday about every facet of shooting the puck, including getting to the hole, skating, and shooting, all being part of the same drills he did to get himself into position and to get the shot away as quickly as he could. And right there, he gets his first of the year after a three-point night last night at the 350 mark. 1-0 Islanders.
Well, he said he was a goal scorer in junior hockey, and that he was, and he wanted to get back to that.
Now it's Faul. Cross for Sakara. Alexander Semin, number 28, launches one off the glove of Johnson, and a second shot from a deep angle is stopped by Johnston as Talushka got in for that rebound.
Well, the Islanders move the puck along again out to Donnie Boychuk, and he's able to get it across to Brock Nelson, a quick pass. So see the holes. The Islanders were getting themselves in the holes, making sure those passes didn't have to go through the Carolina Hurricane players or their sticks. So that's what Doug Wade has been trying to do. Get the guys into the holes, make those passes easier and quicker, and they got the result they wanted.
And so the Islander power play connecting again, now 3 out of 4. When you factor in last night as well, Nelson and Boychuk pick up the assists at 3:50.
Oh, that's how the key times to score those power play goals. Last night, got him a lead again tonight.
However, the puck flubbed there by Brock Nelson, so in comes Riley Nash with a drop to Brown. And that goes wide. Nash trying to dig it loose. Nash number 20, Brown number 36. Brown takes down Grabowski. There'll be a penalty. And the Islanders going right back to the power play and the way it's clicked over the last two games. And remember, one of the Islander goals last night was scored technically at even strength, but Jay Harrison hadn't even come out of the penalty box when that goal was scored. So this is a bad, bad precedent that the Hurricanes are setting for themselves.
Yeah, Brown just gets his stick inadvertently in the feet of Grabowski, but he makes the play happen because he's skating. Got the puck in the zone, Howie, and got his feet moving right away.
Tripping penalty on Brown, 5:17. This Islander power play is brought to you by New York Lottery. Hey, you never know, and it's Falk trying to wheel it out, and he does so with help from Dwyer.
His faceoff win again for the Islanders, and that's a big part of the power play. Winning a faceoff in the offensive zone, it gives you an opportunity to set it up.
Boychuk, Nielsen, they're the point men. Tavares, Oposo, Nelson up front. So again, four forwards, including Nielsen playing one of the points. And an easy clear there for Dwyer. Now the Hurricanes will change their penalty killers.
Yeah, great play by McClemmon in front of the net. John Tavares had Brock Nelson wide open. Not for a heady play by McClemmon. Nelson would have had a wide open net.
Islanders now have changed up. They've got Bailey and Strome out. Oposo around to the near boards for Strome. Bailey to the corner against Gleason. With some help from Oposo. Sets up Tavares. Couldn't get the shot off. And now it's Boychuk scrambling back into the Islanders zone with Malone giving chase.
Fans are still buzzing, Howie. It's like a playoff game in here.
Grabowski feeds the slot. Good coverage there by the Hurricanes, and yet they give it away. Konecker for Grabowski. And finally cleared with 35 to go. It definitely feels as though it could be April, May, or even June based on the decibel level and just the general feeling that you got as you approach the building today.
Fans are sending a message. That's what they're doing. They're saying, hey, this is what you can expect all year.
And now Grabowski back in center, 13 to the power play, trying to wheel away from Gerby. Nudged along by Rask, who carries ahead, finds nothing but blue-shirted Islanders in his way, so he drops it back. And now it's fired back to Rask, who slides it deep into the Islander zone. This power play ends without an Islander shot. Brown is out of the box. Up comes Clutterbuck. In over the line, looking for Cizikas. That's flicked away. Rask turns towards Islander ice for Semin. Good feed. Back to Rask. Oh, and Johnson got his blocker on it. Good save by Chad Johnson. And another shot dribbles wide, fielded by Cizikas. Launches a backhander all the way down. Probably an icing, but no, it slows down. And so icing waved off.
Chad Johnson's best save of the game, albeit it's only 8 minutes in it, but it's a 3-on-2. Well executed by the Hurricanes, and a big save by Chad Johnson, establishing his credibility not only to his teammates, but certainly to the fans.
John Tavares with his first goal of the year on the power play has given the Islanders a 1-0 lead, 12:02 to go, first period.
Well, the Islanders lead 1-0 over the Hurricanes, but watch this 3-on-2 as the Islanders get trapped and the Hurricanes break away. Quick pass with Paluski, Semin, and Rask. There's the quick pass through the middle of the ice. Quick 3-on-2. Beautiful pass by Semin into the middle to Paluski. And they drive now on a 2-on-1. And it was another good pass forcing Chad Johnson to make a save, but a well-executed, Howie, 3-on-2 by the Hurricanes. So the Islanders have to make sure they play smart hockey, not get caught in those 2-on-1, 3-on-2 situations.
Ethan Reinhart breaks up a Carolina attempt at the Islander blue line, but the Islanders don't clear. And so Falk, number 49, checked by Brock Nelson. Goes right back at Rask. And Grabowski picks the puck off. Down the left wing into the Hurricane zone. Throws one to the net. And that's steered away by Anton Hudobin. Nudged loose for Grabowski. That was turned around by John Michael Lyles, number 26, on defense for the Hurricanes. Shots are 7-5 Islanders, just about 9 minutes gone in the first period. Ryan Strait gets the red line. Now a giveaway, and a shot sails wide from Kuhlman as Sakara coughed the puck up.
Great opportunity for Kuhlman. Couldn't have been in a better spot. You've got to make sure you hit the net. didn't get too fine with that shot.
Kara works it across to Falk. Up the left wing now for Talushki. Turn the other way. Here comes Kuhlman, number 86. Stick checking Sakara. Following is Bailey. And the soft backhander floats into the glove of Hudobin.
Islanders forcing turnovers at their own blue line and then turning around with a quick 3-on-2. Good transition game for the New York Islanders. If you're Bill Peters, you're going to be telling your team to get the puck in deep when you don't have an opportunity to carry it in wide. Turnovers is a sure way to lose a hockey game. At least Peters looking at the replay and going, that doesn't work. Let me mark that one down.
Now the draw deep inside the Hurricane zone with the Tavares line on, but again, Oposo taking the draw. And it's temporarily held by Oposo. The Hurricanes recover. Tavares broke that up in center. Honaker and McClement turn each other around. Honaker nudges the puck in. And Sakara finds Falk. Midway through the opening period, 1-0 Islanders. A Tavares power play goal. Andre Sakara chased by Konecker. And Dwyer has to hustle over. And Falk again for Sakara. The defense pair has been on for quite a while, hasn't it?
Yeah, they're looking to get a change, but they've turned it over a number of times. Not much they can do until the Hurricanes get it deep.
And now they'll change the defense. In fact, they'll change entirely. Malone in on the forecheck. The Islanders recover the puck. Martin's pass fails to connect. And this will be an icing as Harrison comes back. And they'll bring it into the Islanders zone with 9:28 remaining in the first period. October 24th, Spike Lee and MSG present a special inside look at Knicks basketball with Derek Fisher and Phil Jackson. What is the triangle offense? It premieres October 24th after Knicks Raptors on MSG Network. You hosting anything called What is the Left Wing Lock anytime soon?
Well, that's what the Islanders are doing basically as a left wing lock. It's a 1-1-3. I'll hopefully get a chance to telestrate that so the fans understand what I'm talking about. I'm sure the Knicks fans want to know what a triangle offense is. I bet you it takes three people though.
That's good. He was in school that day. Islanders with a 1-0 lead here in the first.
Halfway through the first period, Islanders lead 1-0. Brock Nelson continues to play a strong game, and watching him play, how he has the ability not only to create some offensive situations, but he's smart enough to put himself in good defensive position. I watched him as the Islanders forechecked hard. He was the third man high. He was back low helping out his defense. So this kid is learning awful quick to become a very solid two-way hockey player.
And as we've mentioned before, it's in his blood. His uncle, Dave Christian, part of the 1980 U.S. Olympic gold medalists, and his grandfather and great uncle, the Christian brothers, Bill and Roger, on that 1960 gold medal winning team. So bloodlines run deep. And Brock Nelson off to a very impressive start. Hickey for Strome with 8:58 to go in the first. Ryan Strome just slowed down a bit. Everybody else kept going forward, and the play went offside.
Yeah, just dragged the puck a little bit back over the blue line. He was trying to create a little time and space. Ryan Strome, a very smart individual, is on the left side there, so that leads me to believe it doesn't matter what position he plays, he's happy to play all of them. Very creative individual in all situations.
Nielsen, Bailey, Kuhlman, the Islander forward line.
Love to see this line. It's early in the year, but I love to see this unit, you know, find a way to get a couple of goals early in the season, get some confidence playing together. Certainly for Kuhlman and Bailey, really important. As Nielsen has all kinds of confidence.
Kuhlman trying to get it to the net. Nielsen recovers in the corner. Swings it in behind. Kuhlman shrugs off Rask. Straight jumps in. Brian Straight circling the net. Slowed down by Lindholm. And the puck sent all the way down, and that'll be an icing. They'll bring it right back into the Hurricane zone, meaning Carolina cannot change.
Good shift for that particular line, Nielsen, Kuhlman, and Bailey. But like to see them shoot the puck. You know, it's one thing to control it, Howie, but throw it towards the net. you don't have to score in the initial shot, but there might be a deflection, there might be a rebound, and the other forwards have to know that that's where the puck's going when there's an opportunity. I'd like to see more of that from that line.
John Tavares takes the draw, which ordinarily wouldn't be all that newsworthy, but I believe it is his first of the night that he's taken. Kyle Okposo has taken the rest.
Kyle Okposo usually takes him on his backhand, which is the right side, and Tavares, being a lefty, takes him from the left side. That's your strong side if you're a centerman, generally speaking.
Well, there's a tricky ricochet, but icing nonetheless.
Well, that's the Nassau Coliseum, so the guys are going to miss that part of the game, being able to throw that puck up on the boards, particularly as we talked about the Zamboni end, and be able to take advantage of that, albeit it's the Islanders' home end twice, so not nearly as big an advantage as it could be.
And it's to your right as you look at the screen, now to the left and behind Chad Johnson. That is the Uniondale House of Horrors right there, that one little area in the corner. The Zamboni entrance where pucks can wind up going just about every direction.
Anywhere, yeah. And if you're the goaltender for the Island, you certainly don't wander too far from the net when that puck comes around that side.
Well, here's Okposo now trying to squeeze through McClemmon, who slowed him down. McClemmon regains the puck. Okposo tangled up McClemmon, though. And Al Falk in the Carolina zone. Having a little trouble. Okposo keeps the heat on. And Dwyer sweeps it into the Islanders' zone. Boychuk sees Malone behind him. Malone finishes his check. Brad Malone, number 24, he was a teammate of Brock Nelson's for 1 year at the University of North Dakota. Brock is a Minnesota kid from the state of Minnesota, but played collegiately in North Dakota. Hudobin looks to see who's around.
Malone was with the Avs for 3 years in the... Didn't get a lot done offensively. Howie more of a checking winger.
And now Thomas Hickey, former first-round pick of the L.A. Kings. And it's sent right back in. Hickey's got it again behind the play. Clutterbuck and Harrison were roughing each other up a bit, or so it would appear. Didn't see that as it happened. And now Brown looks for Harrison. Jay Harrison played it across. Hamannik slaps away the attempted shot of Ryan Murphy, number 7, who was a healthy scratch last night, but he's replaced Hainsey in the lineup tonight. Ron Hainsey is scratch, and after all of that, it's the Hurricanes who will get a power play here.
Travis Hamannik for Hookman, and he doesn't like the call. It was a battle going on along the boards, and look at Travis Hamannik. You can see his reaction, not happy with that call. But he does get the stick up rather high, although I don't know if he's not being held a little bit, but... There is fair play, I guess. So the Islanders, who have struggled with their penalty killing for the last 4 or 5 years and had a little trouble last night, so they'll make some adjustments, I'm sure, in tonight's game.
So power play for the Hurricanes, who last night were 2 out of 5. A drive by Lyle stopped. The rebound comes to Nielsen, and he gets rid of it, hooking at 13:37 to Hamannik. Lyle's Semin, Talushki, Stahl, and Murphy. The power play for Carolina. Islanders have Nielsen and Nelson up front, which is just wonderful. And straight on defense with Boychuk, testing the broadcasters early. Semin to the corner. Alex Semin drags one, got the shot off, saved by Johnson. Quick recovery, they score. Talushki from right out in front turns and wrists it past Johnson for a power play goal. And the Hurricanes have tied it 1-1.
Ryan Murphy was inserted to the lineup in lieu of Hainsey for a couple of reasons. One of them was the power play. He's a very gifted offensive hockey player on the small side. Watch the quick shot by Semin. He's got a tremendous release. And Talushki, right in the slot area, gets the pass and lets it go right away. Chad Johnson has absolutely no opportunity to get set up. Just a tremendous shot, quick release. That's one thing about Talushki. He's got that good release. He can score goals. We're looking for him to have a big season. And the Hurricanes get on the board early in this first, or right late in the first period. An important goal for him, though.
And a guy who's done some damage to the Islanders before, Yuri Talushki, his 7th goal in 19 career games against the Islanders. Also played with the Toronto Maple Leafs. And the game now even 1-1. Conacher trying to move through center. Gerby got a piece of him. Now Tavares chases down, feeds Conacher. He he scores! Islanders get it right back. Corey Conacher with his first goal as a New York Islander. It took all of 31 seconds for the Islanders to regain the lead. It is 2-1 New York.
Well, this play is really set up because of the shot taken by Hudobin, I believe by Kyle Okposo, and then John Tavares goes to work. Watch this as the Islanders come up the ice. Kyle Okposo is going to get the puck. He's going to just fire it towards net. Great play, but watch the work by John Tavares. He outmuscles Sequeira, and Conacher keeps going to the net. We talked about making sure you get yourself in position because you never know when John Tavares is going to get the puck. Kyle, Corey Conacher says, thank you very much.
Well, it's Conacher's first as an Islander, and we don't have the chance right here, but when we do, we'll tell you about how, for many, Corey Conacher's become a rather inspirational story, given his medical history. He gets his first from Tavares and Okposo at 14:44. John Tavares now with a goal and an assist. He's got a goal and four assists over the first, not even four full periods yet.
And you're worried about the start he had in the training camp. All as I said before, he's a wily vet now. He's been around. He knows all about what training camps you're supposed to get done.
Let me ask you something, too. You've been a coach now. Will you challenge players in the manner that perhaps Jack Capuano did when before the season started, even early last week, he said, you know what? Tavares and Okposo, they've got to be better than they were during training camp. Whether they were pacing themselves or not, is that just calculated on Capuano's part, do you think, just to light a little extra fire under them?
Well, there's no doubt. I mean, you've got to try and get your stars to go one way or another. But I don't think he was too worried about it. Juan Tavares knows his own game, and he was certainly not, I won't say he was taking any nights off, but he knows what the start of the season is all about. He knows what exhibition is all about, and he's proven it in these first couple of games.
The coaches don't always mind ticking off a player if it's to prove a point, right?
Absolutely. Well, hey, listen, you've got to let them know that you're paying attention in training camp, too, Howie. You know, they're just not there blowing a whistle. They can see what's going on.
Nelson, two Hurricanes on him, sets up straight, missed off the inboards. And then Nelson, knocked down by Riley Nash. At the other end, it was Ryan Strome knocking a Hurricane down. Straight again off those end boards. You could tell he was doing that intentionally to produce the carom right to a teammate.
And he wanted to make sure it didn't get blocked. You know, sometimes the forwards get the real good angle. It can't allow you to shoot at the net, so you do the next best thing. Get it by him, allow your forwards to continue with their forecheck.
Twice he did that on that shift.
Ryan Strait, a very smart hockey player, very positional hockey player.
Nice play by Semin, then he lost his balance. Falk throws it to the net, and Johnson's got it. And there's no further play. So 3:16 remaining, first period, in the final home opener at the Coliseum, 2-1 New York. Islanders leading 2-1. Coming up in our forward intermission report, Shannon Hogan will chat with the aforementioned Corey Conacher, just put the Islanders back on top. Stanley Fischler will be in the studio. We'll have highlights, but here's Conacher's goal again.
Yeah, you can see that Hudobin doesn't handle that easy, seemingly easy shot by Kyle Okposo, and then John Tavares goes to work, pounces on the loose puck. But that's what I was talking about, how he shoots the puck. It doesn't always have to be a goal for an attempt. There are rebounds, and there are deflections, and there are mishandled pucks.
And there's Brock Nelson bursting out of the Islanders' zone, surrounded by three Carolina players, so he turns the puck over. Hurricanes look to go the other way. Stahl was locked up by Nelson, and so Brian Strait comes back to play the puck. He spins out under some pressure from Semin. And here's Talushti against Strait. Yuri Talushti trying to get around the net. Goes to the corner. Murphy got a shot on, but was stopped by Johnson. A drive by Harrison blocked away in front. Now it's Murphy as the Hurricanes get some pressure. Lindholm checked by Strait. Ducked back by Stahl. Eric Stahl to Murphy. And across to Harrison. That goes off the stick of Ryan Strome and carries out of play. So the faceoff will stay inside the Islanders' zone.
Yeah, some good pressure by the Hurricanes down low, but the Islanders not panicking at all. Good positioning down low. The wingers were in a good enough position to be able to take those shots away from the points, even though there was a little few screens in front of Chad Johnson. So, as I said, the Islanders have made some adjustments, 5-on-5 down low. A little bit more patient, a little bit more positional play. Not as big a rush to get to the puck.
Played in by Rask, a bouncing puck with which Johnson was able to come out and get. And Conacher now in the Islanders' zone.
A little miscommunication there, and again, that's, you know, new players, new goaltender. It takes a while to get that communication about who should go get the puck. It's almost a you go, I go, Howie.
Well, they're going to go back into the Carolina zone now off the icing with a minute 57 to go in the first period.
Yeah, you had Boychuk out there, Letty out there. So Boston, Chicago, and of course Chad Johnson from Boston. So Letty was out of the mix.
Letty and Johnny Boychuk on the same defense pair, coming over in separate deals last week, but playing together. And now it's Sekera bringing it back. Sekera, pardon me, he was Sekera for a while last year till he told us all just kidding.
Yep, so I don't like that name. It doesn't sound all that good. So Sekera.
We're just the reporters. Played all the way down.
I'll tell you one thing, he's a good hockey player. I don't care how you pronounce his name, he's a very good hockey player.
We got the Andre down pat. There's a silent J at the end of that. Malone puts Hamonic into the boards right in front of the Hurricanes bench. Puck dribbles to the high slot area where it's brought back along by McClement. Looking for Dwyer against Matt Martin in the corner. McClement couldn't steer it loose. Hamonic's got it again. Dangerous pass. Ezekas was in heavy traffic. And now penalty coming up to the Islanders here. Martin will go for tripping McClement.
Now Travis Hamonic made the pass right on Casey Ezekas' stick, but he was checked right away. So as a centerman, you have to be aware of who's beside you, Howie, and make sure you don't get it poked off your stick. Casey Ezekas got to do a little bit better job in the neutral zone. And there's Matt Martin reaching in. Looked to me like he got the puck first and then the skates. If you do that, it's not supposed to be a trip. Matt Martin is in the penalty box.
Of course, the penalty kill is quite a focus for the Islanders this year, as they were 28th overall last year, and they've allowed 3 in 6 times shorthanded already over these first two games, including one tonight. There's Talushny now. With 51 seconds remaining in the period. Islanders box up. Lyles thought about a shot across to Murphy. He shanked his. Talushny follows. Got a shot on that he shanked. And Johnson stopped. That was a broken play that almost cost the Islanders. Talushny to Staal. That goes off the stick of Boychuk. Rams back to Lyles. Half minute remaining in the period. Lyles to Talushny. But he didn't field it cleanly. Now he spins back around. Sets up Staal in the corner. 24. Remaining in the period. Murphy lines up a drive. Blocked by Strait. Dug loose by Semin. Over to Staal. Back out in front. They score. Talushny again on the power play. It is Talushny 2 and the Islanders 2.
And that's about as good a power play goal as you're going to see at any point in time. I mean, you talk about puck movement. The Hurricanes just refuse to get up, give up the puck. That's several opportunities going towards the net. But boy, is this a terrific passing play, and ends up with Talushny getting an empty net shot. There's Murphy, as you mentioned. It's blocked first by Strait, but watch this play by Staal. Got his head up, fires it hard. Talushny recognizing that he has to move, get his feet going, get into the hole, puts his stick down on the ice, Howie, and Staal hits it right on the button, and it's a one-foot tap-in.
Staal and Semin assist on Talushny's second at 19:44, so we're down to the final 5 seconds of this first period. Some good things for the Islanders, who led a good chunk of this period. However, they end it tied 2-2, and perhaps the aspect that the Islanders will focus on most, the penalty kill, which has now allowed 4 goals against in 7 opportunities.
And that just makes you really nervous as a penalty killer. You know, even as a coach, you're going in the dressing room and thinking, we can't take any more penalties. We've got to be smart. Well, then you start to play tight. Then you start to play insecure, and none of those things work. So they're going in the dressing room. They'll talk about it. The coaches will have conversations. But the best way to gain confidence is to kill them.
Well, the Islanders did not kill the 2 in this period. Talushny capitalized both times. Tavares and Conacher for the Islanders. And so, at the end of 1, the Islanders and Hurricanes tied 2-2. Shannon's back with Corey Conacher on the Ford Report next. Islanders and Hurricanes tied at 2, getting set to begin the second period. Tomorrow morning at 10:30 on MSG, get ready for the Giants' big matchup with the Eagles, with Harry Carson, Roman Obit, and Carl Banks on Giants' 1st and 10 tomorrow morning at 10:30 on MSG Network. All right, let's go to our trivia question for tonight, brought to you by Cadillac. I don't know if this necessarily is a portent of something to come tonight, however. The only Islander to score an overtime goal in a home opener, huh? Now remember now, overtime did not become a feature in the National Hockey League's regular season until the 83-84 season. Of course, they did have some overtime way back in the 40s and prior to that, but it was brought back for 83-84, and so you don't have to go all the way back to year one, just 11 years later for the beginning of the overtime era. There's a chance right off the bat for Kuhlman, but it was poked away by Hudobin.
Yeah, crazy hop off that left corner.
Hickey drove one. It might have hit Kuhlman. Comes back to Hamonic, centering feed, but knocked down on his way to the net was Bailey. Islanders keep the puck, and Hudobin blockers one aside. Islanders coming out with a good first shift. Bailey spinning. Bailey tried to get it to the front of the net and hit Falk. And now the Hurricanes are able to squeeze it out. Hamonic throws it right back in. And Hudobin made a pass a little too far for Sakara to field cleanly.
Well, you have to wonder if Jack Capuano thought his team didn't come out with enough fire in that first period, because he seemed to have a lot more jump early on here in the second period.
And so now it's Tavares. Going back into the Hurricane zone, moves to the middle, shoots, deflects, and it's poked away by Johnson. Or pardon me, by Hudobin, as Konecker was headed towards the net. Now Tavares. Poso took a shove from McClement. Poso keeps working, but so does McClement. Tavares in to help. That's evened up by Gleason. Tavares got it again. Put it to the front of the net. Poked away. Recovered by Letty. Boychuk across. Poso. With nobody home in the corner. That creates little room for Lyles to get to it. And now Dwyer hits the red line. Boychuk. Spun it back the other way. And the Islanders looking to change. Poso just throws it back to his defense. And he'll head to the bench.
McClement slow to get up. Looked like he bumped into his own teammate at the blue line. He was very, very slow to get up. What a shift by Tavares' line. You talk about tenacity and drive on the puck. Boy, they were relentless.
Now Nelson tosses it back to Griffin Reinhart. Great and Reinhart, the Islander defense pair. And now Grabowski, head up, finds Nelson in the corner. He's squeezed to the boards by Gerby. Nelson slides it down to Grabowski, and then Strome. Ryan Strome against Rask. Strome showing some strength. And it's an element that the Islanders are hoping that Strome continues to improve on, getting stronger and stronger over this next couple of years.
Now Ryan Strome is mentored by John Tavares, as the Islanders have taken another penalty, so that's a good guy to sort of follow suit.
Rask is going to get the penalty for Carolina, and the Islanders will go to the power play.
Well, the power plays have been very good for both teams, so this gives the Islanders an opportunity to reestablish the lead. But good forecheck by Brock Nelson, and then Rask trying to just really poke check the puck free from Brock Nelson. Again, gets the stick into the skates, and anytime you do that in today's game, and the player trips on that stick, Howie, it's a two-minute penalty. It's a tough call.
Well, the way the penalty killers on both teams have handled things the last couple of nights, it's a huge edge for the Islanders. Rask for tripping at 2:45. And now Tavares sets up Boychuk. Fake the shot, now to Tavares. Bailey's right in front of the goaltender. Now he moves to the corner. Boychuk's drive, stick save, rebound of Poso, looking for Tavares. Couldn't get it there. And then Stahl spun Nielsen to the ice, nothing called. And Talushti moves ahead. Talushti shorthanded, just looks for the lane to tuck the puck in and head off and get fresh penalty killers on.
And Josh Bailey is out there. Brock Nelson normally would be, but Brock Nelson was a little tired from the previous shift.
So here's Bailey to Poso. Out to Boychuk. Nielsen to Boychuk. And now Bailey waits. Bailey to Tavares. On Tavares, Finds Boychuk. Oposo. Nobody in front of the net. Now Bailey backs towards the goaltender. Oposo shot juggled. Perhaps because Hedoman didn't see it initially. He held on. But then Bailey, who was screening the goaltender, is the one right in the middle of that fracas. Jay Harrison has his arm around Bailey now.
Pretty solid cross checks. I think it was Gleason in front of Josh Bailey. This should be a 2-minute penalty for cross checking. I mean, to me, that's a no-brainer. I mean, he really went after him with the cross check in front of the net. So I don't know if it'll be 2-2, but absolutely no doubt about it. They were very slow to call that, Howie. All right, watch the replay. Kyle Pulson, watch the cross check. There's the high one right off that 1-2-3. And then there's the jumping kind of punch. Not sure what Islander
is. It was Tavares. Remember last night, Gleason and Tavares?
Well, look at the cross checks there. Three or four in the head of Josh Bailey, and Tavares comes in to try and help his teammate out. So for me, you know, this could easily be 4 minutes for Gleason and 2 minutes for Tavares, but this should not be equal. In my opinion, this is not a very good call by the referees.
Well, the way things are on the ice right now, it will remain a 5-on-4 for the Islanders as the penalties to Gleason for cross-checking and Tavares for roughing will essentially offset.
And you wonder why you couldn't call the punches. Now, there's Tavares. He comes in and he gets him a pretty good shot. And I have no problems with him calling the penalty on Tavares. Tavares hits him once. Gleason hit Bailey at least three times in the head with a cross check. So that's not just a 2-minute penalty.
Remember, Tavares was saying last night he thought Gleason had been running around a little bit too much and taking some liberties against certain Islanders, one of whom was Corey Conacher. Tavares took a penalty at the end of the second period last night going after Gleason to show his displeasure. But Islanders still on the power play for another 50 seconds. However, it's Faulk for Carolina, finding an opening and wheeling it inadvertently into the Hurricanes bench. He almost beat Cam Ward to the glove side there.
Well, goaltenders are always paying attention whether they're playing or they're sitting on the bench, but that's a good break for the Islanders because that was a clear for the Hurricanes to get the puck down. And look at Cam Ward's going, hey, I made one tonight. I didn't make as many last night as I wanted to, but I got it tonight. So this gives the opportunity for the Isles. Kyle Poso on his backhand to establish control, possibly find a way to score a goal.
Bailey, Nelson, Nielsen, and Boychuk, the rest of the power play. Here's Boychuk. Now to Nielsen. Bailey's in front again. Nielsen up the boards for Boychuk. 34 to the power play. 2-2, early second period. Pass for Nielsen, broken up by Faulk. And cleared all the way down by McClemmon.
I like to see the Islanders shoot a little bit more. A lot of passing, and they've had some success, but you know, the pretty plays aren't always going to work, Howie. You got to get the puck going towards the net.
Here comes Nielsen. Now for Oposo. In over the line. That's steered away by Sakara. And dumped down again by McClemmon. So that'll pretty well take care of the power play. Islanders had two shots. As Rask is set to come out. And the team's now at full strength. Eric Staal being chased by Clutterbuck. Harrison got in the middle of that. And it's Harrison playing it off the board. Right to Talushti. And now Rask. In quickly. And he shot it wide. Talushti bumped by Martin. And Hickey puts on the brakes. Gets the puck back from Bailey. And the Islanders stuck in their own zone here for the time being until Clutterbuck can get rid of it.
Hickey found on his initial pass to Bailey, so it was a slow-moving pass, so Bailey had nowhere to go. He did the smart thing and said, here, you take it back.
And out comes Harrison to center. And Josh Harris, or Jay Harrison, plays it in behind the net. Down low, it's batted at by Gerby, but Johnson stood his ground. Semin pursued by Cizikas.
Well, we'll see who takes the momentum from this penalty killer power play, whether it's the Islanders that use the power play for a little momentum or whether it's the Hurricanes who take the penalty kill and use it for their momentum.
Well, if you kill a penalty the way things have gone the first couple of nights, you're ahead of the game somewhat. But here comes another penalty.
Yeah, not sure who that one's on. Semin standing by the penalty, by his own player's box, so looks to me like he's being ushered over by the referee. Usually when they point at you and they tell you to go to the left, that's never a good sign, Howie. It means you're going to the penalty box. So Semin for high sticking, and there, well, there's a little cross check from behind. Not much there. And there's the high stick right there on retaliation on Casey Cizikas. So the Hurricanes are carrying their sticks rather high. The referees did a good job on that call. And this is a big power play for the Islanders. Really need to reestablish their lead. Let's see if Doug Wade has them shooting the puck a little bit more this time, Howie.
Well, it's Oposo Tavares, along with Nelson, Nielsen, and Boychuk. McClement up front with Dwyer for the Hurricanes, who have Harrison on defense with Gleason. Now Nielsen for Oposo, and then Nelson. He drops it to Boychuk, who tried to get it to the front of the net. Knocked away, but not out. Tavares, good feed to Boychuk. Back to Tavares. His shot deflects. Back to Oposo. Tavares had it at his feet, didn't realize it. Now Nielsen backing it up. Lofts one, looking for a deflection. Oposo grabs it back. Away from Harrison, slipped it right through the slot. Boychuk fires, score! I think Nelson tipped that in. Brock Nelson was right in front of the net, and the Islanders have taken the lead. It is 3-2, New York.
Well, the Islanders did much the same thing they've been doing as of late. Is they've been able to get inside the blue line, maintain good possession, and then this time, as we mentioned, Howie, they shot the puck. They eventually got it back to Johnny Boychuk. It kind of makes a great play in front of the net. He's able to check Tavares, and then Boychuk just lets it go. Brock Nelson's in front. It goes in off of him. There's the shot off the wrong leg, and he shoots it so doggone well. And Brock Nelson has it deflect off his right leg past Dobin. Look at Nelson as he just settles in, and it bounces in with a perfect screen. So the Islanders do the right thing. They shoot the puck.
I think what the Islanders were clearly taking exception to is that belt by Harrison on Nelson after the puck had already been in the net. So John Tavares and Eric Staal, the captain of the Hurricanes, were both just chatting with the referee, John Hebert, and the Islanders, you would imagine, were clearly petitioning for a penalty here because watch this.
On Tavares also. So, yeah, a couple of incidental contact, some cheap shots going on out there. Obviously, the Hurricanes frustrated with their inability to kill a penalty.
Yep, no further penalties were called. The Islanders with the 3-2 lead. And so the Semin high-sticking penalty taken to the face of Casey Cizikas leads to another Islander power play goal.
Yeah, what a great play by McClement, though, on John Tavares just before that goal was scored, Howie. Came back, and that's why the puck ended up with Donnie Boychuk. McClement came back to stop Tavares from scoring, and then Boychuk off the wrong foot. He was supposed to shoot off the front foot. He was shooting off the back foot.
Ryan Strome going wide here against Sakara. And now Brown over to the far side, just gets rid of it. This will carry far enough for the icing as Reinhardt comes back.
You know, let's get back to the shooting, Howie, just so fans understand. It's like all the sports, whether you're a tennis player or a golfer or a baseball player, you always shoot off the front fork. You move your weight going forward, so you establish Johnny Boychuk's situation. He's a right-hander, so you know what? He's got to get his momentum on the left skate, get all the momentum going there. Well, he's just strong enough. That's from all the shooting drills when he was a kid. That wasn't perfect for him, but it was effective.
Well, you know, he didn't play the power play much for Boston. Here he's already an integral part of this one for the Islanders.
Well, Chara and Krug played a lot, Krug lately, and then Chara early on, so Johnny Boychuk, not as much ice time on that area.
Bailey in front trying to get a stick on it, can't. Tavares and Boychuk assisted on Nelson's third at 6:47. Here's Nielsen down low. Bailey is hammered by Faulk again after that puck had already been held by Hudobin.
Well, there's no doubt about it that the Hurricanes want to be much stronger, much tougher in front of the net with the Islander forwards.
They've taken a couple of those shots after the whistles, including one on Nielsen after his go-ahead goal. Monday on MSG, as you see, the Islanders with a lead here midway through the second period. But again, Monday on MSG, Carmelo Anthony and the Knicks continue the preseason as the Knicks tip off against the Raptors. Live coverage gets underway at 7:30. Knicks-Raptors Monday night on MSG Network.
Well, the Islanders leading 3-2, and they've been pretty good on the power play. But look at Doug Wade as he continues to talk to the guys that he uses, he employs on his power play. And they're always looking for things they can do a little bit better. So watch how animated, well, you don't get a chance, but Doug Wade was pretty animated in getting guys to move a little bit more.
From the draw, Clutterbuck got a shot on that was stopped by Hudobin. By the way, they changed an assist on that Nelson goal, took it away from Tavares, gave it to Oposo. Eric Staal is down and injured or slow to get up anyway. There's going to be a penalty here to the Islanders, but also Harrison and Martin. And this goes directly back, I would think, to Harrison, giving that shot to Brock Nelson. Clearly after Nelson had scored the go-ahead goal, and Matt Martin and Harrison are throwing haymakers with Martin finally spinning Harrison down to the ice.
And Eric Staal looks pretty shaken up as he's heading towards the bench. Not sure if that happened right after the faceoff, but Harrison jumped right away. Well, we wonder if Matt Martin played a role in that, on a hit on Eric Staal. And the Carolina Hurricanes can ill afford to lose Eric Staal. I mean, already Jordan out and Skinner's out. And to lose your captain, and you're probably your best forward, your best offensive forward, your best centerman. I mean, he's talking to the trainer, Friesen, and says, I'm okay, but let's watch what happens there. And there's Matt Martin as he just runs him over really from behind. But Staal was playing the puck, so it's not like it was a cheap shot. So that's probably, you know, earlier on, Brock Nelson got hit by Harrison. So this game is starting to have a little bit of nastiness to it.
Well,
Howie,
here's one for you. Duh. It's
yeah.
The back-to-back games. Never mind to start the season, but you know, it seems when you've got these home and homes, there's a better chance of something like this happening before the weekend or those two games are done.
Well, there's no chance to forget. You know, there's a couple of things that go on during the game, and there was some nastiness that went on last night in Carolina's home barn, and it's continued on in tonight's game. And the Islanders, as we know, are not going to back away. They've got Matt Martin, who certainly will sort, but their captain, John Tavares, has established himself as a leader in the physical department by saying, hey, I'm not going to let anybody take advantage of my teammates. We're not going away, to quote him. And certainly Harrison, not sure why he's going to the penalty box, unless he got a five for a game for instigating.
Well, I thought, I must have been wrong, because I thought there was a penalty about to be called after Staal had been knocked down. Thought I saw the referee with an arm up. But there's been no indication that there was anything other than the penalties to Martin and Harrison about to be given out. There's no penalty time posted on the board right now. So unless Harrison
maybe just going for
some sort of repair is the only reason why he'd go to the room.
Yeah.
Unless they do put up some additional penalty time on the board. But as of now, it looks like Martin and Harrison will.
And look at Matt Martin. He's in the penalty box, and he doesn't have a jersey because I'm guessing it got ripped off of his back, and one of the straps is loose. You have Velcro straps, or tie-downs, as you will, Howie, to make sure it doesn't come over your head. I used to say, it can come over my head. I don't want to see those punches if anybody's giving it to me. But Matt Martin can't come out of the penalty box now until he gets his jersey back.
Here's Oposo paying it down low. I think Harrison did get a misconduct. 2 and 5 to Martin and Harrison. Plus Harrison gets a 10-minute misconduct. So they offset, at least as far as the on-ice manpower right now, the extra 10 minutes for Harrison.
We're instigating the fight.
Right.
I'm not sure why Matt Martin gets the 2 minutes for roughing. I mean, if you're in a fight, how do you rough and fight?
Well, you got to start the fight by roughing somebody up. Yes.
Unless there was 2 minutes on Staal for roughing, which is a possibility.
Here is Sakara with still 11 minutes to go, and that's become a rather physical, feisty second period here at the Coliseum, where the Islanders leading 3-2. Grabowski back to play the puck for New York. Islanders changing on the move. Here's Boychuk. Didn't get much on that backhander. And now here's a lead for Malone that he doesn't hold. He and Boychuk come together. And Nicoletti's back to get the puck.
Boychuk got to the corner first. Malone eased up his pace just a hair.
Bobrovsky trying to get through Murphy's check, but the Hurricanes get it out of the zone. So Johnny Boychuk really making his presence felt these first couple of games, physically as well as offensively.
A lot of ice time. I'm sure he's enjoying that very much. And players will tell you, I play better with the more ice time I get.
Nelson had a good chance. Now a drive by Boychuk is steered away by Khudobin.
That was a shot pass as Grabowski was gliding through the slot area. So Boychuk picked him up, and instead of trying to shoot it towards the net, shot it towards Grabowski. He got a deflection, and Khudobin was able to make that save. So Boychuk, good head on his shoulder. He's not a guy that's just looking to shoot the puck at the net all the time. He's got his head up, very much aware. And there's the deflection by Grabowski. Only a good save by Khudobin prevents a two-goal lead for the Islanders.
It would be great if there were more of these home-and-home. Certainly, with the division rivals that you play four or five times.
I agree with you, Howie, 100%. I mean, the intensity level gets revved up a little bit. You get a little familiarity. Like I said, if there's anything going on in any one of the games, you've got a chance to remember. You got a chance to get even. And Matty Martin's now got his jersey back, so he'll be able to return to play. But I love these back-to-back games. I think they're just so much more intense.
Sakara behind the Carolina goal with 9:52 remaining in the second period. Up now to Nash. Riley Nash away from Reinhart, but an interference penalty coming up. With 9:47 to go in the second period, looks like the Islanders going back to the power play.
Now Patrick Brown is in the penalty box for the Hurricanes as the Islanders lead 3-2. Well, we talked about the hash marks on the faceoffs. Let's just see how much they abide by the rules. You can see over here and over here, a little bit inside, but there's a lot of room in that area there. Let's see if they back them up. Here's the hash mark in here, and here's the hash mark here. So the Islander should be back a lot further. Let's see if they encroach a little bit. But you can see the space now, Howie. Much more space. A bigger chance to win the faceoff or lose the faceoff, depending on which side of the ledger.
Here the Islanders control it. They're back on the power play. Tavares plays it out. Boychuk's drive deflected. Tavares has it again. Islanders 2-for-4, the man advantage. Boychuk fired it wide. Big Karam the Nielsen.
The howitzer.
He can shoot it and loves to do so. He's not shy about letting it go. Tavares to Nielsen. He's trying to make up for all that power play time he didn't get in Boston over the years in two nights here.
Danny Gallivan would have a field day with him, wouldn't he?
A cannonading drive, he might say. Raposo to Nielsen. Tavares. Here's that Boychuk drive, but it's blocked. That wasn't in his playbook. But Johnson comes out to grab the puck well ahead of Dwyer.
Dwyer makes a good play. He gets into the shooting lane.
Nielsen's pass beyond the reach of Nielsen. And Lyles goes to his backhand, but gave it up to Nielsen. Now for Raposo. So a mistake by Lyles. Almost exacerbated it by taking a penalty there, but he released against Raposo. Now Lyles again to the backhand, and this time he does clear.
A lot more pressure by the Hurricanes in behind the goal line, not allowing the Islanders the time and space they had in their earlier power plays.
So now Nielsen leaves it for Grabowski as the Islanders are changing on the power play. Conacher found the boards to Bailey in the near corner. 28 to the man advantage. And again, the Islanders have to go back to center. Letty off to Conacher. And now Strome. Neat little pass to Conacher. Trying to burst away from Talusti. Instead, he leaves it to Grabowski behind the net. 12 to the power play. Strome peels it back. Letty to Grabowski. Put it out in front. It's loose. Bailey couldn't get the stick down as it went right past him. Conacher bumped. Letty looks for Bailey. Too far behind him, recovered by Strome. Penalty over. Strome to the backhand. Conacher a shot. And then that ricochets back to the corner to Strome. He's hit by Gleason. 7.5 to go in the period. Islanders up 3-2. And the Hurricanes clear as Gleason sweeps it back into Islander ice. Islanders had one shot on that power play. Lindholm busted a pass. But Cizikas recovers. Checked by Gerby. Khudobin steers the shot away. And now Falk worked it towards the corner. He's met there by Cizikas. Falk came loose with it. And Justin Falk, a weak backhander that Hamonic knocks down. Looks to return towards Nelson. Shots are 17 to 12 Islanders. And now Gerby scooting into the Islanders zone. Just throws one at Johnson. Chad Johnson's had a relatively quiet second period, but that might change here because the Hurricanes will go to the power play.
Yeah, it's going to be a roughing call on Travis Hamonic. Laid a pretty good lick on Gerby as away from the play. Travis Hamonic, a little frustrated to me. He wants to have a physical presense out there. He wants to bring a good offensive presence as well as a defensive presence. But, yeah, you got to keep your emotions in check. Shakes his head, so more often than not, that means you don't like it. There's Hickey as he takes his man out. And I'm not sure what went on there. Travis Hamonic and Gerby went flying high. Feet left the ground, and Travis trying to explain to Matt Martin what went on. But the penalty kill for the Islanders will be tested again.
Well, Hamonic took a penalty at almost the exact same time of the first period. That was a hooking penalty. This is a roughing penalty. And the Hurricanes, two for two with a man advantage, will go to work.
When we talk about the faceoffs, Howie, and now the spacing between the hash marks, and that was a perfect example on that faceoff. Stahl gets it back to Semin, and because he's got an extra half second or so, he's able to cut in behind and get a shot on net.
Nielsen wins a draw from Stahl, and it's set all the way down. Pick up the Carolina power play. They've got Ryan Murphy, number seven here, with Semin, Stahl, Talushny on the left wing. And over on the right point, John Michael Lyles. He drops it back, though. And Johnson covers on a long drive by Semin.
Easy save for Chad Johnson. No one in front of him. A shot from 90 feet away. Good clearing play by the, or good entry by the Hurricanes. Is able to wrap it around and get it back to the point. But you need to get someone going to the net, possibly screening the goaltender, or at least be in a position for a deflection. That didn't happen for the Hurricanes. Relatively easy save for Chad Johnson.
So the draw deep in the Islanders zone. Gains control. Murphy's blast hits Clutterbuck. And then Murphy shanks a pass, but it stays in the Islanders zone. And Talushny, who has both power play goals for the Hurricanes, feeds it back to Murphy. Now across to Lyles. Murphy had a one-timer there. Didn't take it. Now lines up a screen. Plays it across. And the drive by Stahl was blocked. And at nine to the power play. Stahl. The corner to Talushny. Semin turns. He wrists one that deflects out of play.
Nice job by the Islanders getting in front of the, getting into the shooting lanes. Particularly Hickey blocked a couple of shots. Casey Cizikas also in good position. Clutterbuck blocked another shot. So that's what you're supposed to do when you're killing penalties, is take away those shooting lanes. Either get your sticks involved or get your bodies involved. Either one works. The Honor PK did a nice job there.
They're halfway through the kill. Hurricanes control the draw. Sequeira to Falk for a drive. Stopped by Johnson. Gerby gets to the rebound. Nathan Gerby banks it back. Falk across. Sequeira lines it up. Now Falk. Back to Sequeira. Andre Sequeira drifting back towards the point. Now to Falk. Straight on. His drive blocked by Nielsen. Griffin Reinhardt. Penalty kill time. Tries to spin it around the boards. Instead it goes the other way, and Nielsen clears. Half minute remains to the Hurricanes power play.
Island is more bent on getting into the shooting lanes rather than trying to get possession.
And in comes Lindholm. He snapped it wide, and it caroms out of play. With 16 to go to the power play.
Well, the coach has shown a lot of confidence in the rookie. And Reinhardt, Griffin Reinhardt, watch the position in front. He's a physical defenseman. He's 6'4". Good strong reach, good in the corners, good in front of the net. So Islanders struggled on the power play, but the youngster getting an opportunity to perhaps change the way things are working out there on the PK.
So the draw in the Islanders zone comes to Hickey. And Thomas Hickey clears. 10 seconds left to Hamonic's penalty.
Yeah, good faceoff win there for the Islanders with Casey Cizikas. One of the most important parts of penalty killing is win the faceoffs.
Here's a chance off a broken play, but it's shot wide by Terry. So the team's now at full strength. 4.5 remaining in the period. Islanders get their first penalty kill of the night. Three shots were taken on Chad Johnson. And now Lyles back to the Hurricanes blue line, up to Brown, but that slowed down on the way, and the Hurricanes are offside. So we'll step out. Things have started to quiet down a bit. 4:20 to go in the second. Islanders up 3-2.
Maslow Coliseum for the home opener. The Islanders are leading here in the second period, 3-2. Coming up on the intermission report, I'll be talking with newcomer Nick Leddy. Also, there's something happening around the league tonight that only happens twice in a season. Tonight and the last night of the regular season, what is it? I'll tell you. Plus, Butch and Howie will have all the highlights and reaction about the first period. That's coming up in the intermission report. Guys, back up to you.
All right, Shannon, thanks. 4:20 to go here in this second period. Shot 17-16, Islanders. They lead the game 3-2. Boychuk and Leddy pair it on defense here, and out comes Boychuk. Rink-wide feed to Corey Conacher that he couldn't flick deep. Might have clipped the linesman who had skipped up top the boards right at the bench area to try to prevent it. And now it's Oposo wheeling it in front. That's swept away by Sequeira. But now Conacher jumps in. Tavares shot it from long range. Oposo might have gotten a piece of that. Either way, it stays in the Hurricane zone. Boychuk tussling with Talushti. And then Oposo along the boards with Gleason. But the Hurricanes control and come out. Talushti with the fluttering puck over to Semin. Got a shot through, but that's steered away rather easily by Chad Johnson. And Boychuk gets it again. Ready for Oposo. Wild stepped up and comes back to regain the puck. 3:16 to go in the period. Quickly, Patrick Dwyer checked by Leddy. Knocked off the boards, recovered by Lyles. He put it off of Oposo's stick. And so Leddy just gets rid of it. It actually hit his teammate, Grabowski. Mikhail Grabowski. You might have heard him referred to over the years as Mikhail. He prefers Mikhail. Said to me yesterday, whatever you do, don't call me Bobrovsky. That guy's a goalie. And I actually heard an announcer call me Bobrovsky once, said Grabowski. He didn't like that.
No, not at all. Well, you want to be called who you are. You don't want to be compared to a goalie.
Unless the goalie's got Bobrovsky's contract.
Yeah.
Here comes Strom trying to burst down the wing, but support for Carolina comes from Falk. 2:24 remaining in the second period. Line pass by Sequeira, recovered by Lindholm. Elias Lindholm, a first-round pick just a year and change ago. He was the fifth overall pick in 2013. He's pretty quiet these first two games.
He has been, yeah. He's you know, his father used to play for the LA Kings, played 18 games. So some DNA there, Howie.
Strom got a shot on. It's steered away by Hudobin. Lindholm made his presence felt there, knocking Cizikas down.
Lindholm has the distinction of being the youngest Swede to ever score a goal in the National Hockey League. 18 years, 311 days. Landeskog held the record for a while.
Cizikas in! Couldn't get the shot off. Cizikas recovers, banked it off the goaltender Hudobin. And Gleason sends it out of the zone. A great play by Casey Cizikas.
Showing some awful good skill there. Looked like a number one centerman. He's a tricky individual. You know, Casey brings it all each and every game. Every once in a while, he'll surprise you with a pretty good move. Boy, it's just too bad he couldn't have finished that one off because he had the goaltender beat. The puck just slid away on him.
Now Reinhardt to the corner where he's hit by Nash of Carolina. As we come down to the final minute of the second period, Reinhardt's got it at his feet. With a couple of shoves. Now Falk down the boards. Justin Falk, a shot, sits in front off of Johnson, comes back to Sequeira. Now Terry behind the net, who scored last night. Sequeira under a lot of pressure here. Good job by Kuhlman, but somehow Sequeira springs loose. Terrific play by Andre Sequeira, number four.
He just won't give up that puck, really, but Kuhlman staying with him. It's a pretty good battle. Kuhlman keeps his feet moving. Eventually gets the puck away from Sequeira, but boy, you talk about a game within the game, Howie. That was a one-on-one battle with Sequeira and Kuhlman. Neither guy willing to give it up.
Down to 14 remaining in the period. Kuhlman's got it. He throws it into the Hurricane zone. Seven to go. Nielsen in front. Bailey scores! Josh Bailey from Franz Nielsen with 3.6 seconds remaining in the second period. Islanders lead it 4-2.
Well, let's give a big hand to Nikolai Kuhlman because it was all about him and Sekera in their defensive zone. And Kuhlman would not give up where Sekera might have had an opportunity, and eventually it's Kuhlman able to get the puck out. And what a play, what a pass by Franz Nielsen. Looks that one to the stick of Bailey, and he zips it up over the shoulder of Hudobin. But boy, oh boy, you talk about a great offensive play, but it doesn't happen without the great defensive play.
A battle between Kuhlman and Sekera. The period ends with the Islanders up 4-2. Funny thing is, just when it seemed as though Sekera had won that one-on-one battle, because at the end he was able to slide that puck along the line to Nash and keep it onside, the Hurricanes turn it over, and the Islanders get a goal in the closing seconds from Josh Bailey, and they take a 4-2 lead into their room at the end of two periods.
I love that part of hockey, Howie. I love it when two guys go at it. No one backs down, and then something good results from good defensive hockey, and that was the goal by Bailey. And boy, did Bailey need that goal. Franz Nielsen, and look at the smiles on everybody, and the crowd was into it.
I don't know if I've ever seen Jack Capuano smiling on his way to the room between periods. 4-2 Islanders at the end of two. Shannon's back in a moment. Intensity produces our game recap, brought to you by your Tri-Honda dealers. Both Carolina goals scored on the power play by Yuri Telushny. Another good night for Nielsen and Tavares, and Konecker and Bailey each get their first goals of the year as the Islanders march out with a 4-2 lead to begin the third period. And as they do, we're going to go back and revisit our Cadillac trivia question. Who's the only Islander to score an overtime goal in a home opener? Remember, you have to go back to 83-84 for when overtime returned to the NHL regular season. And in its second season, who else? Mike Bossy scored the overtime winner against the Chicago Blackhawks. And speaking of overtime goals, one of the most famous overtime goals in Islanders history. Of course, Bobby Nystrom had the most famous, but the one I'm referring to, the one that really put this franchise on the map, was scored by J.P. Parisi at 11 seconds of overtime to eliminate the Rangers back in 1975. It was a first-round playoff series, the best of three. This goal right here, that really was the birth of the New York Islanders. And J.P. Parisi is back home in Minnesota right now. He's in a battle. J.P. Parisi has lung cancer. And we just want to send our thoughts, prayers, best wishes and appreciation for all that he meant to the early years of this Islander franchise to J.P. Parisi. Hope we can get him well and to the Coliseum at some point this final season.
Yeah, you know, the fans would love to see him, and you know, they'll be thinking about him. And he was a battler as a player. I expect no less from him as he goes through his battle with cancer.
Seven for the Hurricanes along the boards in the Islanders zone. Wilds winds it around to the far side. Oposo's there. It's the Islanders in the midst of a change here. As Oposo tries to kick the puck deep, the Hurricanes get it back, but there's Konecker to just sweep it deep into the Hurricane zone. And the Islanders have that change on now as they've got the Tavares line out. Letty and Boychuk the defense, and Letty finds Oposo at the Islander blue line.
The Islanders continue to have great pursuit and great support if they're able to get to those loose pucks and make things happen.
Rask with a step on Tavares.
Ladies and gentlemen, New York Islanders.
And now Oposo, back at the blue line. Oposo shoots one wide. guess you're wondering, they're just now announcing on the PA the Bailey goal at the end of the second period. Letty angling for one in the third, denied by the stick of Hadobin. Now Tavares pinned to the boards by Murphy. Rask and Oposo are holding each other off with the sticks, and now Lindholm the other way, number 16. Both Islander defensemen back. Lindholm runs into Boychuk as the Hurricanes are changing. Donick or Grabowski, pardon me, angled to the boards by Malone, who recovers the puck. Brad Malone, number 24, lofts it towards the net. Reinhardt was back to knock it down. He's bumped by Dwyer. Hurricanes get it back. Murphy's drive tip, save made. Rebound off the side of the net from McClement, who regains the puck in the corner. Jay McClement to Malone. Now McClement trying to shake loose of straight. McClement put it off the side of the net. Curls behind the net into the trapezoid area. And now for Murphy at the blue line. Throws one into a screen. It's steered away. Sakara, the defenseman, in deep. Hurricanes getting some pressure here. Sakara away from Reinhardt, but he split both defensemen as he threw it up the middle and out of the Islander zone, as it turned out.
Sakara, very much an offensive defenseman. He'll jump up on the play. He'll even get down low like a centerman or a winger when the team is in possession. So you always have to be aware of where he is when you're in coverage.
Eric Staal. Remember, Eric Staal was knocked to the ice at some point in the second period and did not play much after that for the remainder of the period. Just about 2 minutes of the remaining 11 or so. Saw Eric Staal on the ice, but he's out now.
A little shook up. Talked to him the other day, Howie, and I asked him what changes he made to his game, because by his own admission, he had a very disappointing season. He said that he off-ice training was a little bit different. It was more hockey-related, and he changed his diet. I wanted to ask him if he went into the hamburgers and french fries like I did in the 60s and 70s, but no, he didn't quite attune and get in tune with that. It was much more healthier food.
Well, you had In-N-Out Burger out there in California. That's the best.
That's it.
You had an excuse.
These guys here now eat very, very healthy, and Eric was saying that he eats well and he eats smart, but he just, I guess, got into a few more minerals and bananas and all those type of things that all the guys eat now.
The potassium's good for you,
yeah,
too.
Yeah.
Nielsen to Bailey.
I don't think that stuff tastes as good, though.
Nielsen put it off of Hadobin, which is going to be doing cooking shows pretty soon. Rachel Ray and Butch Goring coming soon. Johnson waiting in the trapezoid. Put it around the boards. Dwyer pounces on it. Tried to feed the blue line. Conacher got a piece of it. Dwyer gets it again to the front of the net. Malone, from a deep angle, put it off of Johnson. The Islanders come out. Oposo banks one towards himself against Gleason. Oposo strong on the puck. Got a shot off. And then Gleason with a shot to Oposo. And there's no further play. It didn't look like anything sorted or illegal there. Just good hard play by both Gleason and Oposo. But boy, that's what we just saw from Oposo is what we saw towards the end of the lockout season 2 years ago, and he carried right through last season.
Yeah, absolutely. As you watch Franz Nielsen, sees the goaltender at a funny angle, thinks maybe I got an opportunity to sneak one by him. See him turn his shoulders up the ice. Franz Nielsen spotted that right away. But you're right. This is Kyle Oposo at his best in the second half of the season. He was awesome. He was strong along the boards. But Gleason's becoming public enemy number one for the New York Islanders, as he's been able to get under the skin of a lot of the Islander players.
Oh, that's okay. That's what we love about these home and homes back to back. The Islanders are going to have four more of them, and they're only the remaining four in the season. They're going to come in about a three-week span between November and December. Islanders will have a home-and-home series featuring back-to-back nights, not with two nights in between. Back-to-back games, home and away, against Tampa, Pittsburgh, Washington, and Ottawa.
Well, you know that'll be fun with Pittsburgh, because the Islanders have a lot of fond memories when they play the Pittsburgh team, so that will sure stir some emotions.
Right here, four and a half have been played in the third period, with the Islanders leading 4-2. Semin swings it to the far boards to Staal, and out come the Hurricanes. Palushny held off by Hamonic. Johnson hands off to Hickey. The first pass to Grabowski. Now Strome trying to get down the boards against Falk. Ooh, rams Strome hard into the corner. Good play there by Justin Falk. Get out of the Minnesota Duluth hockey program.
Played for his country in the Olympics. bit of a surprise, but great experience for Justin Falk. Certainly the best defenseman that the Hurricanes have.
And offside the call. Brought Nelson Terry to the Carolina line. Nelson keeps this up. A couple of years from now, we'll start to hear things about, well, maybe next year Brock Nelson will be on the U.S. team.
It wouldn't surprise me. This is a dedicated athlete. And, you know, we talk about how hard he works, and you kind of reap what you sow. And how would you say that's meritocracy? Is that what you would call that? Meritocracy?
That's the word.
That's
meritocracy.
The word. Is that the word? Would you call that meritocracy? Yeah.
Well, the more you produce, the more you're going to play.
Yeah.
And if you don't produce, you find you took us on the bench.
Yeah,
that's
okay.
Basically a meritocracy as it pertains to hockey, I guess.
Well, and that's Brock Nelson, isn't it?
Is that your word of the night?
That's my word of the night.
Meritocracy. I like
yeah,
it.
I like it, yeah.
Here's Martin with a shot. And that's held by Hudobin.
That's for all my Twitter guys.
You got something going on there about
your word of the day? Yeah, we're going to have hopefully a little word of the day as the season progresses.
Really?
But there's Murphy, and that's a giveaway. And Matt Martin comes in quickly, but didn't get a whole lot on it. And he's thinking, maybe I had more time. You know, a lot of times when you're, if you don't get those many opportunities, Howie, you think you have to rush yourself. But Matt Martin had a little more time. Maybe could have deked a little bit to the forehand.
So,
yeah, I'm going to try and have a little fun with it.
Twitter Tuesdays with Butch, I hear we're working on. Huh?
Yeah.
Tavares a shot, and that goes wide. Oh, this has all kinds of possibilities. Letty fails to play it deep, so here's Dwyer the other way, shooting, and a save made by Johnson, who had to be aware of Malone going down the left wing. Back the other way, Tavares, hustling into the Hurricane zone against Sakara. He pulls up, beautifully hits the trailer. Boychuk, who steps up, he shoots, blocked by McClement, and carries out of play. 13:57 remaining, third period. There's a great setup from Tavares to Boychuk. Thanks, Al. 4-2 Islanders here. Hockey Night Live coming up a little bit later on, but great teamwork here between Tavares and Boychuk.
And that's how you do it. You come up to the blue line with speed, you drive the defenseman off, then you make the quick turn, you look for the late coming defenseman, and then you slide him the puck. Johnny Boychuk almost had too much time there because he couldn't make up his mind when and where he wanted to shoot it. But John Tavares, you come up with 100 miles an hour of speed, and you're going to back that defenseman off. And then if you got good, strong ankles, you can make the quick turn like John Tavares made and then slide it in. That reminded me very much of Wayne Gretzky, that he used to do when he was very, very efficient with the puck.
Right here, 6:03 gone of the third with the Islanders up a pair. And it's John Michael Lyles, number 26, carrying out of the Hurricane zone, steering it behind the Islander net. Johnson slows it down. Palushti digs for it, fails to control it, but Semin does. Alexander Semin simply lost an edge there. So he gets a little help from Staal. But the Islanders recover the puck anyway, and now it's Staal who's a little slow to get up and somewhat gingerly skating to the Carolina bench.
Yeah, he's not feeling 100%. He's playing because he needs to play, but he's definitely hurting from that previous hit.
Yeah, he's doubled over.
Yeah, yeah, he's definitely
Carolina
in pain. This game doesn't get closer in a hurry. You might not see a whole lot of ice time.
Oh, out comes Lyles. Under pressure from Strom, though, he's forced back into the Hurricane zone. Gets a return feed from Gleason. And Brown played it off somebody at the Islander bench, and play is stopped. And Staal not even close to being comfortable.
No, you can see he's bent over, he's wheezing, he's shaking his head, and that's not a good sign. And there's Eric Staal. You can see him. There's no real fight to him. Not like he normally plays. This guy's the leader of his hockey team and big time player. But you can see that he's hurting just the way his movement down low.
And again, the Hurricanes missing two very important players. Eric Staal's brother Jordan and former Calder Trophy winner Jeff Skinner. Brock Nelson keeps that play onside, although he's knocked down. And Terry comes the other way. Terry feeds it across. Brown snaps one that's batted away and out of the zone. And remember, these Hurricanes have only lost once in their last 14 games in this building in regulation time.
You would think they'd be due to lose, and the Islanders are on the other side of it. It would be too many men on the ice here, and they got away with it. The referee's got a late call. He saw both guys jump. He didn't see it at all until real, real late. There's going to be too many men on the ice. It's too forward.
Too many.
Yeah, exactly right. Martin, and I'm not sure who it is, but why, here comes the change. And now they're looking here. There's one, two, and there's three, four, five, and there's the sixth. So, but it was funny because two guys were going at the same time, hustling to get over the bench. And you're trying to sneak off, Howie, but that's not the way to sneak off when you're rushing in a tandem to get to the bench. But the referee, the back referee, just caught it at the tail end. Perhaps the Carolina bench was screaming, and he took a look to his left and caught the Islanders cheating a little bit.
So the Hurricanes, two out of three on the power play. We'll get the man advantage off the too many men on the ice. Penalty at 7:52. Hurricanes 2 for 3 with 8 shots. And so the Islanders will try to kill it with Cizikas and Clutterbuck up front. Straight back on defense with Boychuk. And now Clutterbuck turns and shoots. It's juggled by Hudobin. And Semin takes over. Semin, Lyles, Murphy, Stahl, who's back out there. And Talushny, the power play for the Hurricanes. And you're right, Stahl didn't look like he had any compete on that last shift, as banged up as he obviously is.
Yeah, just when you watch him, you can see it in his stride and just in the way he's attacking. You know, he's the captain, and you know he's going to want to play.
Well, here is Stahl.
And he's going off right away, Howie. So he's not right. And if he's not right, he shouldn't be playing at all, because it's a long season. It's the second game of the year, and you can ill afford to lose him for 10 or 12 games.
Minute to go to the power play. Here by Clutterbuck.
And I'm watching him, Howie, and he's over by the bench, and he's just, look at him, he's just bent over. So I don't know what ails him, but he's definitely in some pain.
A little more than half a period to play, 10:52 to be exact, 45 remaining on the Hurricanes' power play. It's gone nowhere, and Clutterbuck is going to force him to make it a 200-foot journey.
And the Islanders have done a nice job in denying the Hurricanes access inside the offensive zone and allowing them to set up and find a way to score a goal.
So Karen and Nash, or rather to Rask, and up now to Justin Falk. It's kept in by Sakara. Hammered out of there by Boychuk. Johnny Boychuk's had some game.
Yeah, he's been very solid. He's had an awful lot of ice time. He's been good offensively, but he's been especially good defensively.
4 seconds to the penalty. Being served by Tavares. And John's back on the ice. Konecker and Oposo are there as well. Konecker to Tavares. Tried to slip it through the legs of Lyles, who would have none of it.
What a pass by Konecker. He's about a foot off the ice, and Tavares took it in midair, batted it down, and almost slid past the defenseman Lyles.
Good penalty kill by the Islanders. They did not permit a shot. 9:45 to go in the third. McClement knocked down by Tavares, who wins the puck, too. But McClement has it again. Powering away from Tavares. Plays it across. Johnson, a good sharp save on a shot by Brown. And Oposo jams it into the Carolina zone, and the Islanders change on the move. 26-22 Islanders in shots. Lusty trying to burst through. He's got both Hurricane goals. He's bumped by Reinhart. Nash in there against Nielsen. Nash to Sakara right at the line. He put it off of Kuhlman. And Nielsen brings it to the Hurricanes' blue line and steers it around the boards. Bailey, who had a huge goal in the closing seconds of the second period.
Huge for a lot of reasons. One for his team and one for him personally.
Kuhlman plays it back. Reinhart hit the side of the net with it.
Not sure if it didn't go off the post. Howie, again, good hard work by Kuhlman in the corner.
Bailey, nice feed. Nielsen, the straight, lines it up. Put it off of Murphy. Bailey dives after it. In to help is Kuhlman. Straight jumps to the net. The pass beyond the reach of Franz Nielsen. With the Hurricanes changing, Johnson with a quick up to straight. And Falk.
Fans are buzzing. They're getting back into it a little bit after the good penalty kill by the Islanders.
And now there's going to be an icing against the Hurricanes with 8:06 remaining in the third, and the Islanders leading 4-2.
They've been a very appreciative crowd tonight, Howie. You're right. They came here early. They came prepared to see a good solid game. They brought a lot of emotions, and boy, oh boy, they've been treated to a very good game. There's Kuhlman with a good work out of the corner. There's the shot deflects out in front, and I believe it caught part of the crossbar or the post. Listen to this Islander fans. Boy, this is as good as it's been this early in the season for a long time.
Islanders with a two-goal lead and 7:50 to go. Lindholm given nothing by Leddy. Nice play by Nick Leddy. Good second effort by Lindholm for a fourth backhander that's knocked away by Boychuk. And back in comes Lindholm. Played a pass beyond the reach of Rask, and Grabowski heads the other way, but he's all by himself, so he just twirls it around the boards, and the Islanders get their change in.
Yeah, he's looking for a change, so trying to delay a little bit, waiting for some help. Good smart play by Grabowski. Got a two-goal lead. 7 minutes to go. Get the puck in deep.
The Islanders just want to keep it simple now.
Oh, yeah, the kiss game again.
Well, here's Martin. Has to reach back for the puck before sliding it deep into the Hurricane zone. And this crowd, which has been airing itself out since this morning in the parking lot, are revved up for the final 7 minutes. Hickey with a shot that's tipped and goes wide.
Nice play by Hickey. Just tried to get it towards the net. Made sure he got past the oncoming checker.
Now it's Casey Cizikas feeding the blue line. Hickey to Hamonic. Down low. That was slapped away by Murphy, the defenseman.
Murphy, the smaller guy, having to do battle with Matt Martin in front.
This gave Martin a pretty good shot, but Martin holds on to the puck. That's what the crowd's cheering about. Hickey throws it through a screen provided by Cizikas.
Yeah, they've done a great job along the boards. The fourth line has had a very strong game.
Now it's McClemmon. Given nothing in center. Islanders go the other way. This is Tavares with Konecker. Tavares got the shot off. Konecker couldn't reach the rebound. And McClemmon trying to get away from Oposo. Wields it rink wide to Sequeira. And over the line against Reinhardt. Good job by Reinhardt. Recovered by Talushny. He scores. Hat trick for Yuri Talushny. And with 5:59 remaining in the third period, it's the Islanders 4 and Talushny 3. His second career hat trick.
Talushny in the right place at the right time. As that puck came from the corner, Chad Johnson decided to deflect it away from the two defensemen that were standing in front to help him out. And he deflected it right onto the stick. Sequeira just throws it out. Well, there's Chad Johnson. He just pushes it right out to Talushny and the two defensemen in front. Can't get to the puck. Good play by Reinhardt. But look at that. Chad Johnson deflects that puck away from Brian Strait, who was going to play it. That's why he was out of position. That's why Talushny was all alone. Chad Johnson making a good move, but it inadvertently didn't work out like he thought it would.
Well, hang on. 5:53 to go in the third. Now the Hurricanes will probably come with whatever they've got left, and we wonder about Eric Staal as it pertains to these final 5:43.
He's not on right now, and with Talushny and Semin there, it's
Nash and
Nash
Staal
is out
spot.
There, so you got Nash and Rask as your two number one and two centers.
Bailey works it into the Carolina zone. Turn the other way for Semin, who is dangerous. Leddy is back to play the puck. Over to the far side. Brock Nelson first to get to it. Pitched it up the boards. Didn't get it far enough ahead. And so Leddy scoops it into the Carolina zone. So, coming up, the Foxwoods Final Five. Foxwoods, excitement every day. And we are down to the final 5 minutes of regulation time. 4-3 New York. Grabowski, now to Nelson. And that deflects out of play. Unassisted goal by Talushny for the hat trick at 14:01. 4-3 New York. The Islanders' upcoming schedule is brought to you by Lexus. A couple of days off after the back-to-back to open the season. Then we'll be in the Garden on Tuesday night to face the Rangers. Sharks will be in here on Thursday night. And then on to Pittsburgh to face the Crosbys next weekend, next Saturday night.
Three tough games. As we pan the Carolina Hurricanes bench, and you'll see there's no Eric Staal. So we've been talking about the fact that he looks hurt, not 100%, while he's gone to the dressing room. So the Hurricanes are going to have to find a way to come back without their captain.
Yeah, they had Riley Nash in the middle between Semin and Tolusti. There's a bouncing puck that comes back to Letty. And Letty winds it around the board. Brock Nelson double team. Strome in there too. 4:36 to go in the third period. Back at the blue line, it's Strome with a drive that got through. Stopped by Hudobin, then Letty fires and missed.
Yeah, good aggressive save by Hudobin, who comes out and cuts the angle down. Had a clear look at it. Got that shot off to the corner.
So now Gerby comes to center and tucks it deep into the Islander zone. The Hurricanes change on the move. And they're getting what now amounts to their first line out with Nash substituting for Stahl between Tolusti and Semin. Islanders have their fourth line out at the moment. Fourth line for the Islanders defensively against Carolina's first line, with the Islanders holding a one-goal lead and 3:58 to go in the third.
And it might be their best checking line. With Matt Martin and Cizikas and Clutterberg, they know all about checking, and they're very physical groups.
This is the deja vu that the Islanders are hoping to avoid.
Well, this is a much, for me, Howie, a much different group, a much more mature group. You have Letty, you have Boychuk, you certainly have the goaltenders, and Kuhlman and Grabowski. So we're talking about some different personnel who have played in tough situations and playoff situations. So they should be able to help settle the bench down.
Well, now you get into an icing situation. One thing the Islanders generally have is depth to replace centermen who might be thrown out, because the Islanders have a lot of natural centermen on their roster. Here, you've got Cizikas between Martin and Clutterbuck, which really isn't the case, but on this line.
This is about the only line that doesn't have two legitimate centermen.
Murphy around for Nash. Hickey's against him. Hamonic now on to Lushny. Good hit by Hamonic to loosen the puck. Martin in the corner, but Semin got it back. Now to Murphy. One missed off the end boards. Clutterbuck chips it out. Cizikas racing after it. Murphy gets to it first. Islanders change quickly. And now Nash. Or Tolusti, who missed from a deep angle.
Dangerously close. Pretty good shot by Tolusti.
But here comes Conacher speeding ahead. Quick shot. And that ricochets off the Carolina defender's stick. And out of play. 3:13 remaining. Third period. Big finish coming up. Tonight on MSG, check out New York's soccer team as the Red Bulls take on Toronto FC. Coverage gets underway at 10:30 following Hockey Night Live. Red Bulls, Toronto FC tonight on MSG. And you are watching the Foxwoods Final Five. Foxwoods, excitement every day. Visit foxwoods.com now. So an offensive zone draw for the Islanders with a one-goal lead and 3:13 to play. Amoso will take the draw. He's got Conacher, Tavares with him. Strait and Reinhardt are the defense, but it's Terry for Carolina getting the puck to center, only to have the Islanders sweep it back in. Falk around to Sequeira, and he plays it up the left wing. Terry slithers it in behind the Islander goal. Terry forced back by Reinhardt. Now it's Brown with Strait on him, and then Terry again for Brown. Nobody around the front of the net. Islanders will take these little one-on-one scrums. Time ticking away. Now the puck comes to the front of the net, but Oposo had that protected. Doesn't clear, though. Sequeira lines up. A shot instead feeds Falk at the other side. 2:29 to go in the third. Now it's Terry feeding the blue line, getting a return pass. Throwing one wide. The carom to Sequeira, who jumped in aggressively. McClement now, and the goaltender, Hudobin, waiting for instructions from the bench. Still a lot of time, and a shank shot allows Tavares to get to center, dump it in, and then he's flattened by Gerby. But we're down to 2 minutes to go in the third.
John had all his weight on his heels, so that was easy to knock him down. Plus, he's a little tired from an extra long shift, but Gerby's a tough little hombre.
And the Hurricanes back in. Bouncing puck to the right of the net. It's loose, comes to the blue line to Murphy. Hudobin still in the net. Murphy with a pass to Lindholm. That's batted away by Johnson. Now Hudobin edging out. He's sprinting to the bench. Carolina's net is empty. They're getting an extra skater on. 6-on-5 for the Hurricanes. Lindholm behind the net. He banks one around the boards. Here's a drive by Lyles. He shanked it, and Bailey nudges it ahead, but not out. Kirby keeps it in. Semin feeds it in behind to Lindholm against Boychuk. Boychuk spins the puck the other way. Minute 15 to go. Lyles along the boards. Put it behind the Islander net. Boychuk protects it. Boychuk finally lost it under pressure. So Semin works the corner against Letty. We're coming down to the final minute. And Bailey got it out of there.
Yeah, good strong effort by Bailey. Just put his body, sacrificed his body to make sure he could get it out.
Murphy lofts one to Nash. He's bumped by Letty. Riley Nash keeps working. Finds Semin. Tried to sweep it in front. Instead finds Nash at the other side. 40 seconds remaining. Murphy fans on either a pass or a shot. That allows a Bailey clear. Empty net at the other end. A race for an icing, and they call the icing. Terry had a step at the dots. And so with 33.3 seconds remaining, there will be a huge face-off in the Islanders' zone, and let's see if either coach takes a timeout.
And the good news for the Islanders is they have two centermen out there. Casey Cizikas is out there. Josh Bailey is out there. So both of them are capable of taking face-offs, but Jack Caporale, I'm sure, is going to take timeout to give these guys an opportunity to get some rest. And yes, he has.
Well, he waits. Sense. Waits until they get back to the circle, then calls the timeout.
Well, it's almost like in football where the coach stands beside the referee and they get the countdown for the late field goal or the timeout, whatever.
Trying to freeze the kicker.
Yeah, you know, wait till it's 1 second. So Jack Capuano waiting until as long as he possibly could. Now they'll just talk a little bit about what they're going to do. If they win the faceoff, then they lose the faceoff. And this is where that extra room in the hash marks will pay dividends for one team or the other. So let's watch to see if the linesman lets them encroach a little bit on those hash marks. And again, if you don't get thrown out of the faceoff anymore, you get warned. And if it happens again, you take a penalty. That's a little different change. The guys last year were encroach a little bit, then switch off and create a little more time.
So Cizikas and Lindholm will draw. Extra skater for the Hurricanes. 4-3 New York. 33.3 to go in the third with an empty net at the other side or the other end. Lutterbuck into the boards. Down to 25. Crowd chanting defense. And Bailey on the loose puck scoops it out of there. Sakara racing back and the Hurricanes will have one rush with 15 seconds to go. Semin at his own blue line. In over the line to Rask. He's hit by Clutterbuck. Down to six. Puck lifted out of the zone, and the Islanders will win. Sakara back into the Hurricane zone as time runs out, and the New York Islanders give a sellout crowd reason to celebrate. In the final home opener, the Islanders will play here at the Nassau Veterans Memorial Coliseum. They're off the bench to congratulate Chad Johnson and each other on a 4-3 win over the Carolina Hurricanes. The Islanders sweep the home and home to begin the season, and they've won their first two games of the year for the first time in 7 years, if you can believe that.
No, I can believe it because we've watched the Islanders struggle for an awful long time. But you know what, Holly? A real good, solid effort. 6 periods of hockey. I like the way the Islanders just played each and every shift. They were pretty consistent. Yes, the Hurricanes threw a little bit at them at the end of near the end of the game, but the Islanders bent a little, but they didn't break. Casey Cizikas wins a big faceoff late in the period. So I just think that, you know, they earned it. They did it the old-fashioned way. So it was a tremendously positive way to start. Good power play, good scoring, good balance scoring, and some pretty good defensive hockey.
We'll hear a lot of horn honking in the parking lot, I'm sure, on our way out of the building tonight as the Islander fans who are embracing this final year in Nassau County have been out here since early this morning. They weren't allowed in the building until 5:30, so they were raring to go for hours and hours. Trying to pick up what they're saying. Is it stay, 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 or I can't tell, to be honest. They just flashed win on the scoreboard, so I don't know if they were chanting win, win, win. I couldn't make it out with my headset on, but we'll get the introduction of the three stars. Third star is Josh Bailey. Remember, the first star will chat with Shannon Hogan.
standing with their high heels, too, on that ice. That's a tough job.
I told you, you might want to think about flats on that ice surface, but... And so John Tavares, the first star of the game, as Jiří Talušný also had a star. And JT will talk about it with Shannon.
Well, John, tonight was a great chance to set the tone for the final season at Nassau Coliseum. What did you guys do to make sure that that happened?
Well, everyone was electric tonight, so it was just fed off the energy and just tried to play smart, play a disciplined game, and just try to execute.
These last two games, the power play has been absolute key. How much confidence does that give you, especially at the start of a season?
It's great. I mean, the weapons we have and the depth is... like we never really had since I've been here. So just continue to have success and don't get away from what we're doing well. So the work ethic and understanding the details of it is what's as important. I mean, all the plays are nice, but we just got to keep working and we'll have success.
How about this atmosphere tonight? The fans were absolutely electric. They're sticking around. They know it's going to be a great season of Islanders hockey.
Well, did I miss this place. It's been a while since playing at home and in front of everyone, so it's just great to be back on the ice, and we want to finish this year right, and first 2 days were good, so move on to tomorrow and get ready for the Rangers next week.
All right, thanks so much, John. Enjoy this win.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Howie, I'll set it up to you.
All right, Shannon, thank you. And amidst chance of MVP two games into the season, John Tavares has captained the Islanders to back-to-back wins. 4-3, the final tonight here at the Coliseum. The MVP race is down to the final 80 games. But we'll wrap up game two from the Coliseum right after this.